I would like to thank the organizers for giving me the opportunity. Sir C.V. Raman, Chandrasekhar Venkataraman provides experimental evidence of inelastics. So he used focused sunlight and colored filters and observed color changes in the scattered light. So Sir C.V. Raman received Nobel Prize in the year 1928. This is his research paper published in Nature. This is the first Raman spectrum obtained with his Raman spectrum. Sorry, Raman spectrometer. So this slide gives a overview of the present talk, like instrumentation using a confocal Raman spectroscopy and the characterization of the sample. Okay. So this is the confocal Raman spectrometer block diagram, and this is the just graphic the Raman spectrum. Raman spectroscopy is a spectroscopic technique typically used to determine vibrational modes of molecules. So the interaction of molecules with the photons causes vibration of bonds, leading to specific energy shifts in the scattered light. So that is identified in its Raman spectrum. So any given chemical compound can be easily identified by this individual fingerprint. So Raman is suitable for analysis of non-fluorescent compounds, inorganic crystalline compounds. So confocal Raman microscope provides submicron spatial resolution in X, Y, and Z axis. Raman scattering is recorded only in the low energy side to give Stokes scattering. So anti-Stokes lines are appreciably less intense compared to Stokes lines. That's why only Stokes part of the spectrum is used. So what are the information we can extract from the Raman spectrum? So we plot a graph of Raman shift versus the intensity. So from the peak position, it depends on the strength of the atomic bond. It is influenced by any changes in the bond distance or string constant. And also from peak intensity or the peak height, on the polarizability of the bond. So it is influenced by any changes in phase amount, crystal orientation, and charge transfer. So our teachers are already told about the polarizability concept. So from the peak width, taking the full width of maximum, it depends on the coherence of vibration. If the peak is sharp, so that we can distinguish that it is a single crystal. If it is a broad peak, we can say that it's amorphous. And peak width is influenced by temperature and disorder or defects in the material. So in the present talk, I am discussing on the following things, that is types of Raman spectroscopy, particularly confocal microscopy, and we have a Vitek 300RS Raman spectroscopy. So the standard operating procedure of this I am discussing with the calibration with a silicon sample, and also I am going to tell you how to analyze a silicon and graphene sample. So with this Vitek RS spectrometer, it's also attached with AFM atomic force microscope and SNOM near field scanning optical microscope. So there are a few types of Raman spectroscopy. One is surface enhanced Raman spectroscopy, SERS. So it offers orders of magnitude increase in Raman intensity. As you already knew that Raman intensity or the Raman signal is very weak compared to signal. That's why. So to enhance the Raman intensity, we are using surface enhanced Raman spectroscopy. Okay. Then is TERS, tip enhanced Raman spectroscopy. So it provides molecular information on the nanometer scale. So it combines the sensitivity of SERS and SPM, that is scanning probe microscope. And it gives chemical imaging of the surfaces at the nanometer length scale. Next is COARS, that is coherent anti-Stokes Raman spectroscopy. So here they are used two lasers. So the one laser frequency will be kept constant and the other laser frequency will be tuned so that it match the frequency to get the Raman active mode of interest. So then is stimulated Raman scattering, SRS. So it's a non-linear process, turn optical fibers into broadband Raman optical amplifiers and tunable Raman lasers. Next is resonance Raman spectroscopy, RRS. So it's an advanced technique used to study vibrational bands in the group frequency region, and it to FTIR, that is Fourier transform infrared spectrometer. So in the next coming slides, I'm going to concentrate on confocal Raman spectroscopy. Here, we need to look into astrometry. Okay, there are two types in which the sample is analyzed. So in the 90 degree mode, in the present block diagram, we can see that the 90 degree mode. So the laser beam is right angle to the collection of lens here. Okay, so in the 180 degree, known as the mode, so that is frequently used in FTIR Raman spectroscopy. If you look at the block diagram, here the light which is falling on the beam splitter and that is falling on the sample, and the reflected backscattered light which is collected over here. On top of it, there is a CCD. So from the CCD, it is moving towards the spectrometer. So you can see that focusing laser light on the sample by using a microscope objective, the pinhole refocus the backscattered Raman signal, which makes it to behave as a spatial filter. After the signal will be collected on a CCD detector to create the spectrum on the spectrometer. So depth profiling with confocal Raman spectroscopy can be applied in two ways. The first approach using plotting of intensity of the specific band as a function of distance from the sample surface. So this provides information about composition or structure of the gradient of the sample. The second phase, to acquire a pure spectrum of a varied structure. So either a dispersive or non-dispersive spectrometers are used. So a prism or a grating, okay, here is the grating, is employed in dispersive spectrometer, whereas in non-dispersive employs an interferometer analogous to Michelson interferometer used in FTIR. So I'll just show you a simple video. So how this confocal Raman spectroscopy is used for depth profiling of the sample. So it's the laser light which is falling on the sample from the reflected backscattered light. Okay, so that is redirected spectrometer. So it is giving the spectrum. So from this sample, molecule can be studied. So let's come back to the our instrument which we have in our laboratory. So this is the Raman spectrometer, confocal Raman spectrometer. So in the left hand side image, you can see that this is the optical microscope. There are two lasers adjacent to this. So behind this, there is the spectrometer which is connected. Okay, in the right hand side, we can see that. So the number, serial number 1. So from there, you are taking the optical fibers, so which is going towards the spectrometer. Okay, so number 2 is the output for additional spectrometers. Number 3 for laser input couplers. We have two lasers. One is 532 nanometer, another is 365 nanometer wavelength. So that can be coupled to this microscope. Okay, so number 4, video camera coupler, so that microscope can be focused onto this. And the number 5, so that is white light illumination. Okay, so that white light can be focused onto the sample, so that can be so focused properly, then we can allow the laser light to fall on that afterwards. Okay, so number 7, this is a microscope turret. So we have a different magnifying lens, so like 10x, 20, 40, 50x magnifying lens we have. So through that we are magnifying the images of the sample surface, so that can be captured afterwards. So there is a position and scanning stages. Okay, so with this we can able to align the sample. With this we can able the sample so that we can move this stage along the 3 axis, x, y and the z axis. Okay, so this is the sample stage here. This is the stepper motor attached to this, so that with the help of a remote we can move this stepper motor along the 3 axis. So this is the pictures. So this is our actual spectrometers that is kept behind the optical microscope. So in this present video, I'm going to explain the standard operating procedure. So that is the instrument we have, that is Vitek RN300RS. So let me play the video. So in the beginning, I will start with the control 5. That starts the software. So starter will take up to 30 seconds. So while the software turns, so we need to turn on the laser. When the software starts, we need to turn on the laser. Okay. Now you can look at the apparatus over here. Okay, so the there is a knob here. If you turn this knob towards the left side, that is the bright focus, so which allows the bright light to fall on the sample. If you turn towards the right side, it allows the laser light to fall on this. So here the detector, the charge coupled device, so that has to be cooled down up to minus 60 degree. So until that, we need to wait. So it will take some time to get cooled down. Now we can see that. So the swing on this, okay, again we are moving towards the left side to allow the bright light to fall on the sample. And we are taking out this rod, we are pulling it out so that the light will. There are, yeah, this is the sample stage, and we are keeping the sample. This is a standard silicon sample which is keeping, we are keeping it on the sample stage here. This is our actual optical microscope image. Now we need to focus the sample using a microscope. This is to adjust the brightness so the sample image can be extracted. The surface of the image can be extracted by clicking on this mountain symbol. Turning. Now I'm turning the knob towards the right side so that I can allow the laser light to fall on that. And I'm pushing the rod so that laser light will fall on the sample. So before that, I'm opening the laser shutter so that I'm switching on the laser. I already switched it on. Now I'm just turning on the laser. So it's a 532 nanometer laser. And this screws, this micrometer is used to adjust the laser power intensity. And this is other laser. 365 nanometer. Now we'll start the oscilloscope to get the Raman spectrum. So the silicon sample we have used, so that I'm getting a very sharp peak at 521 centimeter inverse. So there is a noise is suppressed over here, so that can be removed. To focus the sample using optical microscope, so we can use a remote controller or a joystick over here. So it can be means a sample stage, a piezoelectric stage that can be moved along the three axis, a z axis. To focus the sample, after that I again extracting the Raman spectrum. So now I'm selecting the peak of interest, the data, that is the peak height, peak width, peak position, all the data can be extracted and stored on the computer. Then we need to wait for a few seconds. We have to wait for a few seconds, but then only we need to shut down the computer. Okay, so what are the optics for the sample illumination and the light collection? So the light from the irradiated or illuminated spot is collected by and guided to interference filter or spectrometer to get the Raman spectrum. So this is the optical means this is the sample stage, and this is the optics which are using to focus the sample here. So then the wavelength also plays a major role. Okay, so bandpass filters are used to isolate a single laser beam. The combination of notch filter and high quality grating monochromator is mostly employed in dispersive instruments. So double or triple grating monochromator used to separate relatively weak Raman lines from intense Rayleigh scattered radiation. As we already knew that Rayleigh signal is very strong compared to Raman signal, so that we need to filter out the Rayleigh signal. So that's why we are using these kind of filters. So what is the choice of laser? So by using a different wavelength laser, okay, so we can get a different information from the sample. Like we can go to a different depth of the sample. Okay, so fundamental components of the Raman spectrometer laser source. So the laser source provides a stable and intense beam of radiation. There are variety of laser source can be used here. So for example, argon ion that gives 488 nanometer and 545 nanometer wavelength, krypton ion 530.9, 647.1 nanometer, helium neon laser that gives 638.8 nanometer, near infrared diode lasers that gives 785 and 830 nanometer, neodymium yttrium aluminum garnet that is NDAG laser, so that gives a very high wavelength, 1064 nanometer. So short wavelength source like argon ion and krypton ion lasers generates considerable fluorescence and results in photo decomposition of the sample. That's why while long wavelength source like diode and NDAG lasers can have very high power without decomposing the sample and also eliminate the fluorescence. So in the upcoming slides, I'm going to explain the why the which laser or what kind of laser wavelength can be used. After this, we discussed about the instrumentation part. Now I'll move towards the characterization and analysis of the sample. I've chosen single crystal silicon and the amorphous silicon here. So this is the Raman spectrum for a semiconductor. So there, ion implanted amorphized silicon and the single crystal silicon. Okay. So as you already know that silicon deposited on glass or silicon carbide is widely used in manufacturing of photovoltaic cells. So both the proportion and distribution of amorphous and crystalline silicon are critical for performance. So are therefore important to monitor. So Raman spectroscopy is an ideal technique for its application. Plus the two forms generate readily distinct spectra and blend themselves to give simple quantification methods using Gibbs law. Okay, so this mapping generates chemical images with detailed information on the spatial distribution of the crystalline and amorphous forms. And also intensity of the laser light is also plays a major role here. Okay, so excess excitation laser power can be demonstrated to convert amorphous into a single crystal silicon. So care must be taken to limit the amount of laser power. So silicon-silicon bonds are symmetrical and results in strong Raman scattering. So crystalline silicon has highly uniform bond angles and bond lengths and exits in a limited number of states. This results in a sharp Raman peaks with a characteristic strong band at 521 centimeter inverse. Okay. So while amorphous silicon is less order, so their wider array of bond angles, bond energies, and bond lengths in addition to dangling bonds. So the distribution of possible states leads to broad band centered at 480 centimeter inverse. So that is readily distinguishable from the single crystal silicon. It's a very sharp. So this Raman spectrum used to study the tensile stress put on the sample also. So here in the Raman spectrum, in the plot section of the specimen, in the absence of the applied tensile stress in the left hand side. Okay. There are three major peaks seen in the spectrum. So the strongest of these is located around 520 centimeter inverse, which is a typical Raman peak for single crystal silicon. So while other two peaks corresponds to plasma line. So the shift in the strongest peak at the tensile stress ranging from 0 megapascal to 300 megapascal tensile stress. Okay, so the peak position of the single crystal silicon is moving towards the lower wave number side. Okay, is moving towards the lower wave number side with increasing tensile stress. So regardless of the magnitude of the tensile stress which you are applying, the shape of the spectrum remains symmetric. Okay, when the peak intensity does not change, so this indicates that uniaxial tensile stress is generated on the flow section of the specimen. And consideration in using Raman spectroscopy for silicon analysis, as I already told, okay, so the intensity as the light intensity power, okay, or the laser light power can be. So what kind of a laser light adapted for analysis of the sample? Okay, so here the power of the excitation laser level is increased above a threshold, so that copper silicon is converted to crystalline form. Okay, so in this, we saw no evidence of conversion of amorphous to crystalline silicon at power more than 4 milliwatt. Up to 4 milliwatt, there is no evidence of conversion of amorphous to single crystal silicon. Okay, if you increase the amount of laser input power, so that it's converting back into a single crystal. So in practice, it's possible to collect a good data even from the samples on the glass substrate, okay, so which is thinner than 100 nanometer. Laser wavelength, as I already mentioned, laser wavelength also plays a major role here. Okay, so there are three potentially important effects of excitation laser wavelengths on this application. So one is the Raman efficiency, sample penetration depth, and the fluorescence. Since Raman scattering efficiency is proportional to 1 over lambda to the power of 4, so the signal is much stronger when using a shorter wavelength of laser. So penetration of the laser into the silicon sample diminishes when the shorter excitation laser wavelength is used. So thus, a 532 nanometer laser penetrates approximately 0.1 micrometer into silicon sample, while a 780 nanometer wavelength laser can penetrate up to 0.83 micrometer. So this can be important, as working with a shorter wavelength laser may be way to minimize the interference from the substrate with silicon sample. So that is around 100 nanometer thicker. So there should be no interference when you are using 532 nanometer laser. The fluorescence is also excitation wavelength dependent. So fluorescence is potentially capable of overwhelming the Raman scattering signal. So that has to be avoided. So since silicon fluoresce much stronger at 780 nanometer than does at nanometer, therefore, so fluorescence will be minimized when using a 532 nanometer laser. Okay. So the Raman spectrum of silicon obtained with a blue laser and as well as UV laser light. Okay. So the broad section is the triply degenerate optical phonon at frequency, that is omega is equal to 520 centimeter inverse. So the other lines in the spectrum are plasma lines from the argon ion laser. So their energetic position in the spectrum, so this is because of the result from the atomic transition of the ion in the laser tube. So next I will move into the graphene and graphite sample. So graphene is the fundamental building block of many important carbon, including graphite. So graphite consists of stacks of sp2 bonded planar graphene sheets. So how do you use this Raman spectrum for analysis of carbon materials? Okay, so we have a diamond, we have a graphite, we have a graphene here. Okay, how do you use this for analysis of the carbon materials? So in this slide we can see that, so there are two Raman spectrum, one is for graphite, another is for graphene here. Okay, so I will explain in the next coming slide here. So the prominent peaks like G and 2D, and the other three small peaks, that is D, G star and G prime. However, this D band is absent in the Raman spectrum of a single layer graphene. This is single layer graphene and this is for graphite. So D spectrum, so this D band is absent in the single layer graphene, so that the Raman D band originates. Raman D band originates from disordered carbon atoms in even symmetry. So in well ordered graphene, the D band is absent here. So in this graph, we can see that there is a G band, G star, 2D band. So what are the information we can extract from this graph? So the evolution of the G, G star and 2D bands are the number of graphene layers is increased. As the number of layers increase, so there will be evolution of these bands. So the G band is related to E2G symmetry, that is space group P63 or MMC, and its shape is single Lorentzian curve. So So the intensity of the Raman G band is increases with the increasing layers up to 7 layers, and then decreases for the thicker samples like 23 layers, 40 layers, and that sample. So the G band frequency omega G of a single layer graphene is 1585.5 centimeter inverse, and for bilayer sample 1581.5 centimeter inverse. So that the shape of the G band did not vary, but the intensity is sensitive up to 7 layers. So therefore, the variation in the G band on intensity can be used to approximately identify the number of graphene layers. So that can be seen here. So with up to 7 layers, there is an increase in the intensity. So afterwards, there will be decrease in the intensity for thicker samples. Okay. So the frequency of the G star band, that is omega G prime, redshifts increasing number of graphene layers. So for example, it starts from 2455 centimeter inverse to 2445 centimeter inverse. The shape of G star bands are similar to each other except the single layer graphene. So G star band has a low signal to noise ratio that can be seen here. The 2D band can be used to identify single layer and bilayer graphene. Can be used to identify single bilayer graphene. Okay, the line shape of the 2D bond, sorry, 2D band of single layer graphene is unique compared to others. Okay, so it is a single Lorentzian line shape and highly intense. Its frequency is 2685 centimeter inverse. The 2D band can be used as an exact fingerprint for the number of graphene layers for 1 to 4. As the number of graphene layers increases, the electronic band structure varies and approaches to the graphite. Since the line shape of the 2D band reflects the electronic band structure of 5 to 6 layers of graphite is very similar to that of graphene. Okay, so there are also overall blue shift of the 2D band with increasing number of layers. This already explained. Now, so how do you distinguish a material like diamond, silicon, and a germanium? In case of diamond, where the material consists of highly uniform carbon-carbon bands in tetrahedral crystal. Okay, the Raman spectrum is very simple here. It consists of only a single band because of all the bonds in the crystal are the same orientation strength, resulting in a single vibrational frequency. The spectra of diamond is easily distinguishable from the spectra of silicon as well as from the spectra of germanium with frequency coefficient. So that even though they share the same tetrahedral crystal structure configuration, the heavier atoms of silicon and germanium, so that slows the vibrational frequency and shifts the corresponding Raman band to lower frequency side. And this is the other application of the Raman spectroscopy. So how do you authenticate the jewelry? For example, this jewelry made of different materials, okay, quartz, glass, diamond, and emerald, so that each material gives a specific spectrum, specific peaks. With the help of this, we can able to distinguish what is the material composition present in the sample. So with this, I'm concluding my talk.